What happens when a 4D creature moves around in a 4D world? What does it even look like? Normally, when people refer to 4D, they refer to our 3D space plus time as the fourth dimension. But what I'm talking about here is another spatial dimension that we can move through or rotate in freely. That means new shapes, more degrees of freedom, and more craziness. So how does this work? In 3D, we have X, Y, and Z, which corresponds to left and right, up and down, and forwards and backwards. When we move to 4D, we add W, which corresponds to the directions Ana and Kata. Here I've just drawn an arbitrary direction because technically there is no correct way to draw this in a 3D view. So that begs the question, how do we truly see things in 4D? Trying to visualize 4D is a bit like trying to imagine a new color. Nobody knows how to do it. By the way, that's not a new color, that's just caramel. That being said, there are still ways we can understand the space. Imagine you are a 2D being that's just been thrust into a 3D world. Setting aside the imminent freakout and existential crisis, you would probably notice a few things. First, you notice that things seem to just appear and disappear from view, often contorting in weird ways. This is because your vision is now a cross-section of this 3D world, so things only appear to you if they're inside your cross-section. Before, you could only go horizontally or vertically, but now you can travel forwards or backwards, or even rotate in new ways. From our 2D perspective, this looks a little strange, but from 3D, we can see it actually makes perfect sense. Using this knowledge, we can see how a 3D view works inside a 4D world. Everything here might look 3D, but none of it actually is. These are all 4D shapes. Wait a minute, what are 4D shapes? Well, in some cases, 4D shapes generalize from 3D and 2D. Let's take a square. If we clone this square and connect the corners, we've now formed a cube. Now, if we take this cube, clone it, and connect all those corners, we've now formed a tesseract, which is the 4D analog of a cube. And get this, if we spin this in a weird way, we are now able to start our new career as a Wikipedia article. We can also go beyond 4D simply by repeating this cloning and connecting process. Each time we do it, we go up another dimension, eventually ending up with a 10D shape known as the decoract. Yes, that headache you're feeling is normal. Another way we can generalize 4D shapes is with circles. Simply put, a point on a circle is always exactly one radius away from its center. This concept generalizes beautifully to spheres, and, as you might have guessed, a hypersphere, which is the 4D analog of a sphere. We can take the square and circle concepts and combine them together. This gives us two new 4D shapes called the cubender and the spherender. Then there are things that pretty much don't generalize, like duoprisms, which come from combining two separate 2D shapes together along different axes. As you can tell, this analysis is severely limited by my lack of understanding of what I'm doing. But when has that ever stopped me before? Let's move on to rotations. Now, in the past, I've explained rotations in 3D as sticking a skewer through an object and twisting it. And while this makes sense in 3D, it's not entirely accurate. Rotations are 2D operations. Literally any rotation, in any dimension, happens on a pair of axes. For example, let's take yaw. Normally, I would represent this as rotating around the Y axis, but in reality, the rotation is only creating motion on the X and Z axes. So it actually makes more sense to define the rotation as XZ. Or in general, the two axes that the rotation actually affects. This is especially important in 4D. By finding all the unique pairs of X, Y, Z, W, we can see that there are six different rotational planes. For anyone who's curious, I actually figured out how to calculate how many rotational planes any dimension has, which made me feel like a genius, until I found out some baguette muncher had already done that 400 years ago. Another thing to realize is that when we rotate in 4D, there are now two axes that aren't being used, which is enough for another rotation. So, 4D has this unique property where we can perform two unique rotations to the same object at the same time without them interfering with each other, which we call a double rotation. Alright, hopefully you're still with me because that's all the 4D we need to know. So that brings us to the next question. How the hell did I implement all this? Let me just clarify that this question alone could warrant three different videos, so I'm just going to summarize what happened. If you would like some more in-depth videos about this, let me know in the comments. Alright, our first problem is the transformation matrix. In a 3D game, we use this 4x4 matrix of numbers to position, rotate, and scale things. So logically, we would need a 5x5 matrix to achieve the same thing in 4D. Now, an important part of matrices is being able to invert them, which is a little expensive on a 4x4, but surely it can't be that much worse on a 5x5.
Oh. Oh no.
Luckily, you don't really need the extra row and column. because you can just work with the 4x4 and add an extra operation to include the position, which made this wonderfully easy to implement, and I was able to add this without much trouble. Next, we have to render the models. This is tricky. In 3D, meshes are made out of triangles, a 2D shape with 3 points, 3 edges, and 1 face. When we leap to 4D, we make meshes out of tetrahedra, which are the 3D analog of triangles, featuring 4 points, 6 edges, 4 faces, and 1 3D cell. For anyone who's curious, I actually managed to figure out how many features a piece of a mesh in any dimension would have, which... Wait a minute, I've seen this before. Wait, no.
Why are you everywhere? Why is this everywhere? How is it always linked to this goddamn triangle?
Now, we've established that 4D meshes are sets of tetrahedra, but how did I draw them to the screen? Well, first, you got to send in 4D meshes to the GPU, which I did by manipulating the vertex data you would normally send in 3D, so it was sending in tetrahedra data in 4D. So I was essentially Trojan horsing the GPU with 4D models.
It's 4D! Get it!
Next, you have to clip down the 4D models to the portion that is visible in our 3D view, meaning that each tetrahedron is rendered as up to 2 triangles. Normally, this would create a complex and lengthy shader, but you can just brute force all the possibilities offline and reference them in a lookup texture. It took a few attempts to get this right, but eventually I got it working. If this sounds familiar, it's because I learned how to do this by annoying Code Parade on Discord until he explained it like I was 5 years old. Shout out to Code Parade, awesome programmer, and he made a pretty cool game about this topic, so be sure to check that out. Finally, I need to actually create the 4D models. This is a little tricky. You do have this program called Miratope, which can generate some of the 4D primitives, but in general, I made most of my models using custom scripts. This included extrusion, procedural terrain, and even creating a 4D pyramid, which was just generating 3D mazes for each level and making sure they were connected. Yeah, this was not fun. Let's talk about physics. This was even less fun. In order to implement 4D physics, I had to learn a whole new form of maths called geometric algebra, and by learning geometric algebra, I found that the equations in physics engines can be generalized to any dimension. Why? Well, some things in life are mysterious. Why does Pascal's triangle keep popping up? Why does my Discord think I'm American? Why does the preview of my 4D materials look like a condom? Nobody knows. No, the real reason is that geometric algebra shows us that some of the things you learn in 3D are actually specific instances of ideas that work in any dimension. Rotors are a great example of this. Rotors create rotations. In 3D, they are defined as a scalar and 3 bivectors, identical to a quaternion, a common component in most game engines. I swear, does anyone even listen to this? Alright, I'm just making sure. In 4D, rotors have a scalar, 6 bivectors, and a quad vector, which sounds weird, but it helps track the double rotations. So rotors can be expressed in any dimension, as long as you know how many groups with...
Welcome back, my petit frère.
So as I was working with geometric algebra, I realized that everything I was using followed patterns, so why not program them? This led me to creating a geometric algebra compiler in Python, which meant I could simply write whatever function I needed and it would give me the code to integrate it into my 4D engine. This also means I can compile expressions for any dimension, which is pretty cool. Maybe I'll attempt a 10-dimensional AI in the future. Now that I had this compiler, I could convert all the 3D physics maths into 4D with barely any effort. Obviously, there's a lot I'm not touching on here, but again, we would need a whole video to discuss this. Alright, I feel like we've arrived at a great place. Physically, mentally, geometrically, and we can now fully appreciate what comes next. The AI. Let's do this one more time. Since this is 4D, our AI will have a 4D body composed of a hypersphere, 8 tesseract legs, and 30 eyes. So it's basically a 4D spider. It's also 1.7 meters tall and takes up roughly 0.9 meters hypercubed of space. Or if you're American, well, that didn't make much sense to begin with. So our 8-legged 4D friend will also be running a small neural network, trained with reinforcement learning. The AI will also be able to control itself by applying torque, meaning it's essentially a 4D wheel. It will be able to see things using depth sensors through its 30 eyes, and it'll be rewarded by how well it moves in the direction we command it to. So a simple setup for a sophisticated system. Let's see the training. Thank you. After 11 hours of training, we can now see that the AI appears to have mastered 4D movement. But let's put this to the test. A couple of weeks ago, I accidentally tripped over and spilled all my orange M&M's all over this 4D world while double spraining my ankle. Now it's up to the AI to get all of this food back. Good luck, 4D Spider.
Of being a genius, but struggle every month to do your exams? Would you like to have a brain like mine, but don't know what to study? Brilliant doesn't just help you learn, it makes you a better thinker. a better problem solver with thousands of interactive lessons in math, science, programming, and AI. When I was 24 years old, I made a decision not just to learn, but to become a better thinker. No matter who you are or where you came from, you too can become intellectually independent.
With lessons built in hands-on problem solving, I was able to learn 6 times faster than watching lecture videos.
Learning a little every day is one of the most important things I ever did for my personal and professional growth. Brilliant keeps you on track to reaching your learning goals, one day at a time.
Try a programming course. The timeless problem solving skills you develop here will help you thrive in the ever-evolving world of tech. Don't just sit at home, or the brain of your dreams will sail right past you. I changed all these people's lives, and I can change yours too. Join now and get a 20% discount on an annual premium subscription.
Good to see you again, Blubber. You're under arrest.
You're gonna be joking. Get the f*** away from me.
Hey, turn that camera off.
I'm shooting a goddamn info commercial here, you bastard. F*** you. You don't have anything on me. Get off me. I'll make you another skin again.
Hey, Blubber, let me give you a bit of legal advice. Shut the f*** up.
You little piece of...